7 misconceptions about evolution. In this video, I'm going to mention 7 things that helped me to understand and accept evolution. I went from someone that used to believe it was a great materialist conspiracy, mainly because of the books of Harun Yahya, and, you know, never looking into it, to someone that actually looked into it and found that there's a great amount of undeniable evidence for the theory of evolution. Evolution is not a matter of faith. It is not an atheist ideology. Many believers in God also believe in evolution, and you can also be an atheist without believing in evolution. Evolution by natural selection is said to be the greatest single idea that a person ever had, by some. It has given us a better understanding of our place in the circle of life. Evolution is just a theory. I'm going to quote from Islamic scholar Yasir Qadhi, and I quote, "There is almost consensus in the scientific community that evolution is a fact. That it's not just a theory, but it's actually a fact. All life as we know it originated from a common human ancestor, and the only opposition is coming exclusively from religious circles who view the scriptures as providing an alternative explanation to the origin of life," end quote. So when scientists use the word theory, it has a much different meaning from everyday use. In science, a theory is not just a guess, a hunch. It's a well-substantiated, well-supported, well-documented explanation for the observations. The theory of natural selection, or the theory of evolution by natural selection, is the best explanation for the fact of evolution. A valuable theory will allow you to make predictions. This is very important. Keep in mind that if someone finds a hole in the theory of evolution, it doesn't make the opposing idea any better. Actually, there might come a point in time where we revise and we come up with a better model for how life has evolved on Earth. Just like how Einstein's theory of relativity explains the facts better than the Newtonian model. A valuable theory gives you the power to predict. The reason why scientific theories are useful is because they allow us to make predictions. Just how accurately we can make predictions tells us how useful the theory is. In 1862, Darwin received some orchids, some flowers, from Madagascar, which had a really long nectary, 30 centimeters long. And he predicted that this must have evolved alongside a moth with an exceptionally long tongue. Was Darwin right? Well, not until 130 years later, in 1992, did people observe the moth, known as Morgan's sphinx moth. How did Darwin figure this out? Because his theory was incredibly accurate and matched the facts. Point number two, evolution has never been observed. Actually, it has. Look at pests that become resistant to pesticides or germs resistant to antibiotics. We can see in front of our very own eyes how organisms change and evolve to survive in the environment. Another example, look at how our ancestors domesticated wolves into dogs. We have carefully selected the genes and bred for the characteristics we wanted, which is also known as artificial selection, to breed dogs into the largest variety imaginable, from the tiny pug to the Great Dane. This is what evolution does. But it's the environment that shapes the resulting organism, not human hands. Also, look at what we did to make cabbage transform into kale and cauliflower. In the same manner that we chose the characteristics that we wanted to breed for, nature does the same thing by the process of natural selection. Point number three, there is micro but not macro evolution. Micro evolution is like a turtle's shell changing. Macro evolution is like a dinosaur becoming into a bird. Now the thing is, many small changes, micro changes, will lead to big changes. There's nothing in science that prevents DNA changes to stop from accumulating from a small one into a big one. Like, really, we only see religious people who make this distinction because they cannot deny all of evolution, because obviously some of it you can see. Point number four, why do we have so few fossils? Well, actually the answer is you need to do a little bit of paleontology. Fossils are extremely rare. For a fossil to be preserved, it has to be buried very quickly before the environment can damage it, before it decomposes, before it erodes, or gets eaten or otherwise damaged. Chances are very low for fossils to be saved intact and preserved. As well, the fossil must be in a location where humans will one day intentionally dig and find them, not destroy them by accident, not build on top of them, and has to be close enough to the surface that we can get to it easily. This is why we don't have a lot of fossils. Point number five, there are no transitional fossils. Actually, there are transitional fossils. Following up on the previous point of how difficult it is for fossils to be preserved, we do actually have some very good examples of transitional fossils. The first one is Archaeopteryx. Archaeopteryx is 150 million year old, half bird, half dinosaur. The second example is Tiktaalik. Tiktaalik is an example of a half fish, half amphibian. Both of these examples show us that they are transitional forms. Point number six, there is no geological evidence. Actually, there's solid evidence from geology as well. Notice a pattern? Here's what it is. Soil accumulates in layers. The oldest layer is at the bottom and newer layers are on top. As you dig deeper, you'll find fossils from each era. Now, what do you think we'd find when we dig down? If evolution is true, what would we find? Okay, we would find mammals on the top, and as you go deeper, you would find fish and then reptiles and so on. For example, you wouldn't find a dinosaur bone at the top and then find a mammal at the bottom and then find some fish in the middle, right? You would find a specific set of layers. Guess what we find? And I'm going to quote from a book because he said it so well. Daniel Steele in Atheism Explained says, "The fossil record, for example, completely bears out the Darwinian theory that all land vertebrates, animals with backbones, are descended from fish, and that mammals and birds are both descended from reptiles. In other words, we find fish in the early strata where there are no land vertebrates. Then later we find land vertebrates as well as fish. In rocks of just the right age, we find animals transitional between fish and land vertebrates. And we find reptiles and amphibians before we find mammals and birds. Later, we find both mammals and birds alongside reptiles and amphibians." End quote. Another amazing quote. Dawkins, in his book, The Greatest Show on Earth, says, "If fossils of living things were found randomly in all ages of rocks, with rabbits, birds, and flowering plants in the earliest strata, evolution itself would have to be abandoned as an account of how the different kinds of living organisms came into existence. The fact that there's literally nothing that you can remotely call an animal that has ever been found in the Devonian rock or any older stratum. They are not just statistically rarer in Devonian than in later rocks, they literally never occur in rocks older than a certain date. Evolution, in other words, is a falsifiable and therefore scientific theory." End quote. There you go. Evolution could be disproved if just a single fossil turned up in the wrong order. So far, evolution has passed this test with flying colors. Point number seven, evolution has stopped now. Actually, no, it hasn't. Evolution never stopped. It continues to this day. Even now, we are evolving. Italian wall lizards. Italian wall lizards introduced to a tiny island off the coast of Croatia are evolving in ways that would normally take millions of years to play out, new research shows. In just a few decades, the 5-inch-long lizards have developed a completely new gut structure, larger heads, and a harder bite, researchers say. And this is from National Geographic. In conclusion, evolution is not just a theory. It can be observed, as indicated in the Lenski experiment, on how germs develop immunity to antibiotics. There's no real difference between macro and microevolution. I explained why there's so few fossils and how some good examples of transitional fossils like Archaeopteryx and Tiktaalik. I've also explained how geology proves evolution, how evolution continues to this day. There is no better model or theory than the theory of evolution by natural selection. Look at the evidence for yourself. Pick up a book like Dawkins' book, The Greatest Show on Earth, which I found very fascinating, especially for someone that doesn't have a scientific background. And learn how it works for yourself. Thank you. Bye.